Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. Nothing could be finer than to be in Carolina in the morning. That's the song that they sing. The second line of that, I guess the Lord really gave it to me, because the second line says, nothing could be sweeter than my sweetie when I meet her in the morning. In the morning. And that's the song, nothing could be finer than to be in Carolina in the morning. It's an old song, I guess from the 20s or something like that, I don't know. But anyway, now that I mentioned that second line of it, you know, there's the Song of Solomon, you know, and there's a surface meaning to that. You know, there's a surface meaning. This reminds me of someone that that I talked to before in Texas. They couldn't understand that there was deeper levels and understandings and meanings to the Word of God. They only saw, and I think that's the difference between thinking spiritual and cardinal. There's some people look at the cardinal thing, and just like this text I'm going to read to you from Solomon chapter 2, Song of Solomon, people think that, you know, it's a love story and almost pornographic, and they say, why is it in the Bible? Because it's just kind of pornographic in the surface text. But in a deeper meaning of the word, brothers and sisters, it's really the Lord's love for His bride, the church. And the rapture is even in here at a different level, in a deeper level than that surface meaning, which is supposed to be between King Solomon and this Gentile woman that he loves. You know, but in type and shadow, King Solomon is a type of Christ. And then, of course, the bride, this Gentile woman that he's in love with, you know, she's the like the church. So let me read this to you. And this is what the Lord spoke to me. And that's why I'm looking at this text. I made a video about this about a year or two ago. Song of Solomon, chapter 2. And this is the same text. There's a sister in Texas. She couldn't understand there could possibly be a deeper meaning to the text. It just made me laugh. I was just laughing because people, you know, you have to have ears to hear and eyes to see. You got to pray and say, Lord, you know, give me, let me have a spiritual, let me have a, you know, not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Let's be led by the Spirit. The Bible said those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8:14. Okay, let's see. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 1. I am the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley. Now, you guys have heard that song. Obviously, lots of theologians know that this is referring to Christ, because there's the song, lily of the valley, and he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. You know, there's all those names that are names for the Lord Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. So this is widely known, but you don't hear people preaching on it too much because it's kind of abstract. You know, the New Testament is filled with so much good stuff. We don't really see so much preaching out of the Old Testament. Okay. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 1. I am the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valleys. As the lily among thorns, so is my love among the daughters. As the apple tree among the trees of wood, so is my beloved among the sons. I sat down under his shadow with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me, this is one thing that's a reference to the rapture. And I, like I said, I made a video a couple years about this, but the Lord led me to do it again right now. He brought me to the banquet house, the marriage supper of the Lamb, and his banner over me was love. His banner over me was love. You know, Moses, you know, when I first got this word from the Lord and understanding a year or two ago, two or three years ago, the Lord also gave me that Jehovah Nissi, God is my banner. And Moses gave that name because his brother-in-law, and Aaron, his brother, the high priest, first high priest, they had to hold up his arms so that Joshua and the children of Israel would be winning the battle. And they were on top of this mountain. And then every time Moses would get tired and lower his arms, they would start losing. So his brother-in-law and his brother held up his arms. And then they won the battle. And then at the end, you know, Moses called the place Jehovah Nissi, God is my banner, because he was holding up that banner, you know, the power of God. And so the Lord had me studying that. I didn't know what it meant. And then the Lord gave me this verse as a cross-reference. So the banner of the Lord over us is not about physical war as it was in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament. You know, even as the Bible says, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard, which is a banner also. The Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. You know, in the army, they call a flag a standard. And that's just another name for a flag, a banner. You know, the banner of an army. You know, they have those horn blasts, even, you know, up to the American history in the last 100 years. They blow the retreat, reveille, taps, all that stuff they would blow, and then the people would, you know, when I was in the Army too, when you go in training, they still have what they call a guidon. Each platoon has its own guidon bearer, its own flag, its own banner. And then when they blow those trumpets or what, or they, in the modern Army, they will call you, you know, to fall in, to get information. You fall in with your colors. You fall in with your banner, under your banner. You run to the banner that's, you know, is your banner. And so the Lord's banner over us, the church, is love, not war, not violence, not victory and all those things, even though that's all part of God. But the banner over the church, the bride, those who will be raptured, the five wise virgins, those who have overcome, those who have kept the word of his patience, he will keep us out of the hour of tribulation that will come upon the whole earth, Revelation 3:10. Or Luke 21, 30, verse 36, it says, you know, those who heard and heeded the word of the Lord when the Lord Jesus himself commanded. When you see all these things happening, all these signs pointing to the tribulation period, he said, watch always, therefore, and pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Verse 5, stay me with flagons, comfort me with apples, for I am sick of love. I'm lovesick. His left hand is under my head, his right hand doth embrace me. I charge ye, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the roes, which are like deers, gazelles, and by the hinds of the field, that ye stir not up, nor wake my love till he please. The voice of my beloved, behold, he cometh, leaping upon the mountains, skipping upon the hills. My beloved is like a roe or a gazelle or a young buck. Behold, he standeth behind our wall. He looketh forth at the windows, showing himself through the lattice. My beloved spake and said unto me, here's another rapture verse, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. For lo, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of the singing of the birds is come, and the voice of the turtle is heard in our land. The fig tree, listen, Jesus referred to this. Jesus said, behold the parable of the fig tree. When you see the fig tree budding, putting forth fruit, you know that spring is near. Even so, it's the coming of the Son of Man. He's talking about how winter's over and spring has come. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. I don't know who else is teaching this part or if anybody else is teaching. Listen to me. Spring has come. Winter is over. The land of Israel, the nation of Israel, has gone through a winter since AD 70. They've been in exile and all that stuff they went through. 1948, they started having the springtime. Actually, before that, 50 years before that, when they reintroduced Hebrew, all those things, as the Zionist movement got rolling, they moved back in there, declared themselves a nation as Israel, 1948. Then, 1967, took the Jerusalem, city of Jerusalem, the Temple Mount, and all that. So winter is over for the nation of Israel. He's talking about our land, the nation of Israel. You know, if you read this story of Song of Solomon, this love, this woman who's in love, she says, you know, don't wake up the daughters of Israel until my love is ready. You know, don't let Israel come accept the Messiah until he's ready. Let them sleep. Let them sleep. But this woman, if you read the story, the Song of Solomon, this woman is a Gentile. She's dark and ruddy, it says. You know, she's not a fair daughter of Jerusalem. She's a foreigner. She's dark. She's you know, in the story, she's not a prize. But yet, King Solomon chooses this woman who's not one of his own people. She's not a prize. She's a nobody. She's a Gentile, but yet he chooses her. That's us, the church. But don't wake up those beautiful daughters of Jerusalem. Don't wake up the Jewish people who will accept the Messiah until the Lord says so, until by Rosa Field that you stir not up nor wake my love till he please, until the Lord wants them to be awake. That's verse 7, Song of Solomon chapter 2. Now let's see, verse 11. For lo, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, and the flowers appear on the earth. Jerusalem is budding, as the Bible says in lots of other Bible verses. It's coming, it's budding and all that. The time of singing of the birds has come. It's summertime. It's the rebirth of Israel, and the voice of the turtle is heard in our land. And the, I want to see what it says for that turtle, turtle dove. It's not a turtle, see, it's a turtle dove. Okay, just like the dove that Moses sent out, right? Okay. And it comes back with an olive branch in its mouth. There's so many meanings to this about the peace and all that, right, brothers and sisters? Verse 13, and the fig tree putteth forth her green leaves, her green figs. Jesus referred exactly to the fig tree. He's referring to this text. Brothers and sisters, wake up. God is revealing to his people what the wisdom of the ages. the mysteries of his word. And the vines with the tender grapes give a good smell. Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. That's the bride, the church. O my dove, that art in the clefts of the rock, in the secret places of the stairs, let me see thy countenance. Let me hear thy voice, for sweet is thy voice, and the countenance is comely. This is the church, the bride, talking to the Lord Jesus Christ. Take us, the foxes, the little foxes, spoils of the vine, for our vines have tender. My beloved is mine, I am his. He feedeth among the lilies until the day break and the shadows flee away. Turn, my beloved, and be thou like a roe or a gazelle or a young deer upon the mountains of Bether. I can go on and on with it, brothers and sisters. I just want to do that one chapter because, I want to keep it. I don't want to do an hour-long video. I want to just lay that out to you, brothers and sisters. The Word of God is filled with the things of God by the Spirit, brothers and sisters, since I just showed you. Reference, reference, reference. Three cross-references to the rapture and even from the words out of the Lord's own mouth about how we know the signs of His return. When that fig tree buds, when spring comes to Israel, the rebirth of Israel. Of course, in the Bible, two or three different times, God calls Jerusalem His fig tree. And Jeremiah is one example. God calls Jerusalem His fig tree. Brothers and sisters, our time for departure is so near. And that's why, I keep announcing that's what people want to hear. Time for departure is near. Okay, we got that. So, what are you doing in light of that? What are you doing in light of the fact that the Lord's about to come for His bride? Are you being a wise virgin or a foolish virgin? That's what my videos are about. The whole reason why the Lord gave me the Church of the Firstborn, the online church I started. And I will, by the grace of God, as the Lord has told me, plant home churches. All the places I go to, my intent is to plant home churches, you could call them that, home Bible studies, groups on Fridays and Saturday nights, whenever people can meet, everywhere I go, to start preparing the bride to meet the groom, to be part of the five wise virgins, brothers and sisters. We need to equip ourselves to be ready at any moment, in the twinkling of an eye, to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. We must prepare ourselves. Finish the race that the Lord has set before us. I can see, and I made a video about this a long time ago, I can see the armies of the living God. Brothers and sisters, and there's people in that army, that are at different banners. And there's banners of people who are half wearing their armor. Some people are wearing all of their, few are wearing their whole armor. And some of those who are wearing their whole armor, brothers and sisters, because as a brother wrote in one of his, a brother wrote in a book about something that the Lord showed him. He had on this bright armor. He had all of his equipment on, all of his armor of God, and it was so shiny. And someone said, here, put this filthy rag over your armor. And he said, what is this filthy rag? And they said, and it was an angel told him, said, put on this filthy rag. And he said, what is this? It was a dream he had. And the angel said, this is a garment of humility. And he said, I don't want to put that filthy garment on because it's going to cover up my beautiful shiny armor. So he started walking. And then later on, he thought about it. And he heard the voice of wisdom reminding him to put on the garment of humility. And he stopped and put on the garment of humility. And as soon as he did, brothers and sisters, the shining off of that armor was so bright, he couldn't see clearly. And when he put on that garment of humility, then he could see clearly. Just in front of him was a pit full of snakes. That he was just on the edge of falling into that pit of snakes. And he could not see it because of the shininess, the glow off the brilliance of the armor that he had gotten through his prayer life, studying the Bible, praying, fasting, all of these things. But yet, because he wasn't wearing a garment of humility, he almost fell into that pit of snakes. Brothers and sisters, there's people in the army of God at all levels. And there are some who've got on all their armor, and then the next thing you know, they don't have any humility. That's why, brothers and sisters, people need to be warned. Pride goes before a fall, haughty spirit before destruction. But there's lots of people in the army, the vast majority of the people in the army, they're not even wearing their armor. They're playing, sleeping, clowning around, not in formation. I spent 10 years in the army, 9 years and 9 months in the army. And I guess, part of the reason why I was in the army, the Lord was preparing me for these days, as that church up there in New York, the Harvest Army. It is an army. We are an army. And then, as a matter of fact, I heard a famous preacher, R.C. Sproul, who is a Calvinist, and like a Presbyterian or something, but he has lots of good wisdom. Anyway, somebody asked him, and he took the questions and answers. When I first became a pastor, I used to listen to this radio show station, and they only played stuff like that. But there's lots of good things. And someone stood up and asked him, he said, is the church a hospital? Or is it, you know, like a military? Is it, is it a war? Are we treating people, or are we, fighting? And his answer was good. He said, well, we're a hospital and an army. You know, we do both. We help people, heal people, treat people, but yet we should be prepared to make war. And so lots of times, just like the orphanage, brothers and sisters, the orphanages, say we have two orphanages going on three. It looks like in January, by the grace of God, we'll be building a new orphanage, and I'll be going to the Philippines for January and February. From January 15th to March 15th, 2015, by the grace of God, going to the Philippines to build a new orphanage. But as an example, brothers and sisters, like the orphanage, lots of people love to donate for the orphanage. And of course, we need to have donations. We can't do it. It takes money to build the orphanages, to feed the orphans, to buy their school uniforms, blah, 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 all those things. But that's only part of being a Christian. That's just one piece of being a Christian. I had someone message me, and it's like, I don't know if they really say it like this, but it's basically like, how can you do anything besides orphanage? I just paraphrase it. Because orphanage, running an orphanage is not the end all of being a Christian. It's just one piece. It's just one part, brothers and sisters. There's lots of things about being a Christian. Number one is our relationship with the Lord, right? Our prayer life, reading the Bible. Then you get into, bearing fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and going out and being salt and light and all those things. And, some people use the expression from the Old Testament, tithes and offerings. Some people believe, also that we're not under the law, which we're not under the law, that we don't do tithes and offerings. But in the New Testament, it says God loves a cheerful giver. And Jesus said, give and it'll be given unto you, in good measure, pressed down, running over. Will men give to you? Because Jesus said, by the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. So, Jesus gives us that principle. You reap what you sow. He who reaps sparingly will reap, sows sparingly will reap sparingly. And that's in all things. Jesus talked about judging people. He said, judge not, lest you be judged. For the same measure you judge with, it'll be measured back to you. So when you say, hey, all these, I can't wait for the destruction to come, destroy all these people. Hey, you have to watch it. You have to watch it. And I watched myself many times, especially when I was new, because I would start, talking junk about somebody that's not a believer or somebody that's blaspheming God and all this kind of stuff. And then I was like, well, wait a minute. I need mercy. I need grace. I better sow mercy and grace. I better ask the Lord to give that person grace because, when the day comes down to it and I'm standing before the Lord and then the Lord's going to play back where I'm like not giving other people grace and not giving other people mercy. And then I'm asking for grace and mercy. Well, the Bible says you reap what you sow. It's a theme throughout the Bible. And it's, it's a principle, as the kingdom people say, kingdom dominion people say, it's a kingdom principle, which it is. We reap what we sow in all things, brothers and sisters, in all things. God bless you guys. I'm going to cut this off. God bless you. I love all you guys.